So welcome everyone. Let's continue the process of finding or kind of getting in touch with our psychic and living through the psychic. And as we were discussing last time also, that why must we do it? I think we were reflecting upon that. What's the need? And we know that it's almost an urgency that we, all of us, not a few of us, but all of us who are getting a bit sensitive that yes, you know, they would continue this suffering if we don't really get in touch with our true essence or the psychic presence. So that was the reason why we are putting effort, since we were talking about effort. So that, and I think we may also have covered, but maybe like to reiterate this, that parallelly, you know, I'm removing the kind of, I'm noticing the uglinesses, weaknesses in myself, areas where I want to improve. And parallelly, I also have to strengthen whatever is beautiful in me, you know, whatever I like to do. So things which make me feel joyous. And I think we were sharing about that. Some of us had shared about that. So to always get, be in touch with that part of us which wants to express itself in some or the other way, you know, that finds joy in either dancing, learning music, or it could be just anything, something which is really beautiful and gives us joy. And everyone is different and unique. So there is no one set formula here, but anything that brings us joy. And through that, we become more intimate with ourselves and progress forward. So that is absolutely essential, whether we are adult or children. Usually our focus mostly is on the children. You know, that children should learn this and that. But as adults, we become too boring, you know, that we don't have a life of our own apart from children. So it's time for us to kind of get in touch with that kind of the presence within, which always wants to learn, always wants to progress, and to keep, give it nurture, give it feed, which is a good feed, just like fertilizer we give to plants and flowers, you know, so that it grows. In a sense. So that thing, let us keep in mind to have some beauty in our life, no matter from where it comes, it doesn't matter. Because we often forget, many a times life is too overwhelming, you know, especially for those of us who may have kids, and kids demand attention and time and effort, and you're earning for the kids. Many times we have jobs which may we may not really appreciate much, but still we have to earn. So can we parallelly have also some time to nurture ourselves, to make our lives beautiful? Because if my life is not beautiful, people who are in touch with my life, I cannot give anything good to them. So I think that's one thing which is very, very important. Most of the times, I would say also a few things which are impersonal in nature. I had stressed upon it. Impersonal means that do not require people around. For example, it's not a social activity, because then you're dependent on people. You know, if agar people nahi hai, then I'm feeling like what to do. You know, I don't even know how to sit with myself. So to any do any activity where you sit with yourself, like in the older times, any activity, doing it mindfully, you know, even, you know, when you make these spices at home, dry potato wafers at home, you know, these little things like these, they require a lot of stillness and thairav in the being. Otherwise, you cannot imagine doing it. So it's good that we spend a few hours at least in our day in such activities which have the power to still our being. Because we lack this stillness nowadays, especially with all the, you know, the gadgets and so many things to distract us. So anything that where we can just be with that thing and being still with that thing, being intimate with that thing, could be any activity. For some, it could be cooking. So that doesn't matter. So let us keep that in mind as long as we are alive. And yeah, this we already did, bringing a sense of fulfillment. So keep sharing if there is anything. I'm just concluding the part of what we were doing earlier, rejection and I think effort, rejection and all that, that we are concluding today. psychic living. So this is something by the mother. It would be nice if one of us reads it rather than me reading it. And then we come to choice and change. So mother shares something on psychic living. Anyone who wants to read this out for all of us?
Yeah, I can read, Monica. So, psychic living. Whatever you do, never forget the goal which you have set before you. There is nothing great or small once you have set out on this great discovery. All things are equally important and can hasten or delay its success. Thus, before you eat, concentrate a few seconds in the aspiration that the food you are about to eat may bring your body the substance it needs to serve as a solid basis for your effort towards a great discovery and give it the energy for persistence and persevere in the effort.
Yeah, so this excerpt is taken from these 11 points given by the mother on the journey towards the psychic. There she has delineated for us 11 points. So that even if we just stick to those 11 points and do nothing else, I think that's enough. So I have shared many a times these 11 points in many, many sessions earlier also. This is a part of that. That first of all, never to forget. Because we forget. All of us forget. Other things become too important. And we forget to notice what was my goal at all, you know, what is my aim in this life, which we are going to talk about today in choice and change. We'll talk about the aim, setting up an aim in life. And that's why it's easy to get distracted because I don't even have any aim in life. You know, only little aims, ki yahan se doodh le aao, achha, aaj ka khana kha lo. So these little aims depend, you know, mother says that on the quality of your aim will depend the quality of your life. Very simple sentence and very, very powerful. You know? If my aims are little and very material, my life will also be little and material. But if I give myself a higher aim, a loftier aim that, okay, let everything come and I'll take everything in my stride and learn from everything. That is a decent enough aim. It sets our goal kind of good forever. So then we don't bother about little happenings in life which we cling to and which our mind clings to. The ego mind, it clings to these little things if we are not clear in what is my purpose in life. Because if my purpose in life is to grow, then no matter what situation is there, I will grow. No? But if I don't have any purpose at all, or I don't give attention to what is my purpose at all, what is my aim in this life as human being, then again and again, little things will stick to me. You know, if I'm going to catch a flight and somebody says something to me on the way, like insults me, I won't have enough time because I have to catch a flight. But if I'm just wandering around and somebody says something insulting, I'll stop there and have an argument with that person. Why? Because I have nothing else to do. You know, no meeting to attend, nothing to do. So I'm just here with the person arguing and talking. Why did you talk to me like that? But if the flight, which is a bit, I'm just using the flight as a metaphor. It could be anything. So something more. If my aim is to grow in consciousness, so even if my loved ones may insult me, reject me, which will happen and happens with all of us, how does it matter? Can I take it in as a raw material on the game? Because it is allowing me to come closer to myself. So, good. I'm not saying to allow abuse to happen, but little happenings won't need to be taken to heart that we usually do. So there comes the importance of goal that we set before ourselves. We will come to that today in a couple of slides. And then Mamadhar is sharing that there is nothing great or small once you have set out on this great discovery. Now, I have chosen for myself that I want to find out my true being. I want to find out who am I, who I truly am, what is my true nature. I have heard Buddha says, be your own light. Where is that light in me? let me find it and unite with it. So if this, I have set my aim, then nothing is great or small. So any little incidents that happens through during the day, you know, daily, homely incidences, they can become a raw material on the path. Now, I don't need to go to an ashram or live close to Pondicherry in order to, you know, attain my true nature. So it's very, very important, although living in Pondicherry may have its effects, because Mother says that there is good energies there. They have, because Sri Aurobindo and Mother have been there, but yet we know that we can make our environment. We have that power. So also to have faith in us, you know, that let me utilize my free will and make any place beautiful wherever I go, having that confidence in oneself. So, and nothing is great and small, even little incidences of life can be put to use. We can learn from them. Thus, Shoshi is now sharing that if nothing is great or small, so if I'm going to eat, which is a very mundane activity, you know, so can I just set an intention right while I'm sitting to eat? So instead of a hunger or desire, can I just pause even for a two seconds, that may this provide me energy and freshness to go forward on this march, to do this divine work. Because realizing our true nature is divine work. So all things are equally important and equally can hasten and delay its success. Thus, before you eat, concentrate a few seconds. Mother also says, not a few minutes, because people may be hungry. You know, we may be really worked out and hungry. So she says, just a few seconds, give it that, may this food give me the vitality needed for the path. Enough. Becoming more mindful and aware when we are eating, rather than just eating and not even knowing what the food is doing in my body. So thus, before you eat, concentrate a few seconds in the aspiration that the food you are about to eat may bring your body the sustenance it needs, because the body needs sustenance. We know how troublesome our bodies can become. You know, all of us have experiences with diseases. So if the body is not sustaining well or cooperating well, I cannot have much hope from my sadhana. Body is the instrument of sadhana. So how can we exclude it? So bringing your body the substance it needs to serve as a solid basis, so that the body remains supple, healthy, you know, relatively healthy. Things may happen here and there, but relatively supple, agile, vigilant, solid basis for your effort towards the great discovery. And give it, great discovery is finding my true nature, uniting with my true nature, you know, and shining that essence out in life, and give it the energy for persistence and perseverance in the effort. So if I can remember that, that would be really nice. Yeah, anything anyone wants to add on here? Okay, so if not, I'm just taking further this excerpt. It's the same excerpt. I can share it with all of you again on the WhatsApp group also. 11 points Mother has stated, journey toward the psychic being. So this is another part of that excerpt. And here she talks about, here she talks about sleep, you know, and act. So anyone who would like to read this would be nice. Just this passage by the mother on sleep and action.
May I read it, madam?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Before you go to sleep, concentrate a few seconds in aspiration that the sleep may restore your fatigued nerves, bring calm and quietness to your brain, so that on waking you may, with renewed vigor, begin again your journey on the path of the great discovery. Before you act, concentrate in the will that your action may help or at least in no way hinder your march forward towards the great discovery. When you speak before the words come out of your mouth, concentrate just long enough to check your words and allow only those that are not in any way harmful to your progress on the path. Never forget the purpose and goal of your life, Mother.
Thank you. So, you know, somebody asked Mother about shooting stars, you know, that if you see a shooting star, is it true that people say that whatever you wish is granted? And then she said that there is some amount of truth there, but what happens is that shooting star happen very instantaneously, like it's just very sudden. Now, if there is no one thing which I am concentrating on in my life, for example, I'm concentrating on may I grow in consciousness. And every time that's on my mind, that let anything come, I will grow in consciousness. Now, when a shooting star is there in front of me suddenly, because it just appears suddenly, then the only thing on my mind is growing in consciousness. So it's like some, you know, astral happening is happening, and I can bring my frequency there and say that may my wish be granted, you know. But Mother says that usually we are not even knowing what we want. You know, we have very little ideas in our life, little aims. You know, may I get this person, may I get that person, may this happen with my job, may I get that property. So then we don't remember what really, you know, is so crucial for ourselves, our own being. So she says that if you have something really which is on your mind all the time, then when the shooting star is happening and you pray or, you know, make a wish, it's good in the sense, like good fun. So that's what she's sharing again and again, that never forget the purpose and goal of your life. But do we have a purpose of and goal in life? That's what we will be checking today, you know, in the further slides. So she says, before you go to sleep, again, I have been doing this since I've been in touch with the Mother, you know, while when you are falling into sleep, consciously falling into sleep, not like dumb, you know, gone. You're so tired that you're just unconsciously falling asleep, because sleep is takes a lot of time, you know, like 8-9 hours we may be sleeping, or maybe 6 hours. And if you calculate how much of years we give to sleep, it's 1/3, I think, if I'm not wrong, 1/3 of time in our lifetime, we are sleeping. So if it's an unconscious sleep, then what's the fun? You know, you are fainted or you are behosh all the time. 1/3 of the time in life, you are behosh. So it's good to make the sleep also a little conscious. You know, and to be aware of being aware, so, or at least to become mindful of what's happening. So you're lying down, you relax your nerves, you know, and let me just focus on sleep for some time, and then we can put this slide share again. So, bringing your attention back to breath while you are lying down is one way of bringing the mind in the body. Because usually the mind is lost here and there. It's not in the body. So bringing attention, bringing mindfulness to the breathing, you know, when it's coming in and going out, focusing on the sensation, body sensation, just focusing on the bodily sensation of breath while you are going to fall asleep. And if there is a thought where you get lost, again to bring your attention back to the breath. Again to bring your attention. Again, thought will come, you will get lost. Again to bring your attention back to breath. So that is one way to bring mind to the body again. And not mind is somewhere else and the body wants to sleep and it's an unconscious sleep. We don't even know and we are slept. And many a times it may happen that the mind is so active that we are not able to fall asleep. So in that case also, coming back to the breath really calms the mind, stills the mind. And stilling of the mind is necessary because our minds are not stilled. So bringing them to the breath again and again, and then noticing the body from inside, you know, that, okay, let me go into the body. Taking the help of breath, you go into each part of the body, you know, the toes, the calves, the buttocks, the upper area, you know, one by one, you go into a complete body as if you do a check-in. You do a supervision of what's happening in your being. You know, and you just, it's just a non-judgmental supervision in the sense you just check in that I'm here. Okay, I'm back here now. If we were absent the full day, and even if we were present, to again bring the mind to the body, because the mind has the tendency to get lost in the thoughts. We do get lost in the thoughts again and again. So to completely bring the focus to the body, the sensations of the body, not the thoughts, not the feelings, the sensations of the body, and just staying with them, not wanting to change them, erase them, shoo away, nah, bilkul bhi nahi. Just staying with the body as it is. Like as if a friend has come back home. No? And like that, going into sleep. So that really, really, really helps. And it's a little bit better than the unconscious sleeps. Although sleep yoga has many, many stages, so we can still go further into sleep yoga, where we begin to notice our dreams, you know, and in the middle of the dream, we are able to be conscious that I am dreaming. You know, that's part of dream yoga, sleep yoga. But that requires a lot of effort. If I am unconscious during the daytime, I cannot expect that I am conscious during the dream time. So if I'm now beginning to step back from my surface activities of thought, feelings and sensations in the daytime, then I can slowly continue this in the sleep time also. That slowly I can begin to be aware of my dreams and what are they telling me, you know, because there are many a times significant dreams also, which are trying to tell you something. At times there are not much significance, but it's just a random mix here and there. But at times there is some message that comes out, and if we are able to harness it, so it helps. So becoming a little, mother says that basically what we have to do is becoming conscious of each and every part of our life. How we sleep, how we act, how we speak in words, you know, how we react to situations, how we do, for example, the daily dusting and whatever we may be doing. Becoming more mindful there. So becoming conscious and aware of the happenings of the day. And so if I'm thinking, maybe I was focusing on my inner self and again I've gotten lost in the thoughts. So to become aware that I have gotten lost, just that is enough for the time being. Okay, I got lost again. Okay, let me come back to the breath. So as if there is a guard who is having the supervision of the complete area, you know, and it's not that a mindless game is going on. Anyone wants to add on anything here? Okay, so I'll continue. So before you sleep, concentrate a few seconds. Again, not much required, just a few seconds. If we can take out that time for our own self. In the aspiration that the sleep may restore your fatigued nerves, bring calm and quietness to your brain so that on waking with renewed vigor, you may again begin your journey on the path of the great discovery. Yeah? So that this growth in consciousness can go on and on and on. Before you act, now we are acting all the time. All the time we are doing a little action here, there, you know, everywhere. Before you act, concentrate in will that your action may help or at least in no way hinder your march towards the great discovery. Now, if this is on my mind that each of my acts that I do during the day should be not a partnership with the falsehood, which is the ego, but should be a march towards an expansion of the being and wideness and empathy and kindness, love, compassion for others. You know, so putting my needs back, you know, ego has all the time needs. You must have noticed every time ego has demands. But now we also realize that how long will I serve the demands of the ego? Because this does not help me. So you put the demands of the ego aside. Okay, you have this demand, you set aside. Let me do which is necessary. Let me do which is important and beneficial for myself and the other person. So you put the demands of the ego or the vital, you know, vital emotional being. Always it will have demands and expectations from people and life. But now, since we have ran enough, we put it aside in the corner and then we attend to something which is necessary to be attended, which is more important than serving the demands of the ego. So this concentration, even for a few seconds, that may this, whatever interaction I'm going to do, may it serve the growth of consciousness of whatever people involved. That would help. That really, really helps. Because most of the times our intention itself is not right. We recognize when we become aware more about our own actions and, you know, whatever we do in the day-to-day life, we see that most of the times we are a slave of the ego. And in that we remain empty. It's not that the ego's tummy ever gets fulfilled. And we think that we are the ego, but we are not the ego. Because if I was the ego, I should have been fulfilled by now. So many desires I have fulfilled, so many, you know, expectations I have been fulfilled. It's not that all of them have not been fulfilled, but still it remains empty. Still it remains empty. So not to focus on the demands of the ego, let it keep aside. Okay, you know, there are unfulfilled wishes and desires. Everybody has that. No big deal. Let me focus on something which is higher, lofty and important. Yeah. When you speak, before the words come out of your mouth, concentrate just long enough to check your words and allow only those that are not in any way harmful to your progress on the path. So bringing anybody down, you know, rebuking people, rebuking my own self, how bad I am, how unworthy I am, you know, all these games are just games of the ego. So whatever wants to be big, and whatever wants to be small in me, the victim or the one in pride and vanity, that's the ego. Ego is not settled with being a nobody. It always wants to be somebody. Kuch to bana do, acha bada nahi bana paye to chota bana do. You know, main hu victim. I am the victim. People did bad to me. So that's also the ego. And when we say that I am the one who is all powerful and beautiful and I make things happen, doership, there also it's the game, same game going on. So to see that whatever words are coming out of my mouth, is this serving any good? Would this make anyone grow in consciousness? And if it would not, then maybe not really speak them out, you know, the unnecessary arguments we are talking of here. Not if you want to ask somebody to make tea, please go ahead and say that. No, but just the unnecessary talk that we do most of the times. You know, we really drain a lot of energy there. So to abstain from that drainage of energy and parallelly to put that energy at a good place. You know, any place that we were talking earlier that you like to do. Good place. Yeah. Yeah, anything anyone wants to add on? Any reflection to share?
While talking, we should be very, very careful. That is the message we are getting here. And also, one the sentence you have uttered before beginning of this one, one should be good to give good to others. It's a very powerful sentence. So in talking also, we should talk very good words only we have to use. We should not use the words that will harm our progress and also it will hurt the others. Is it not, madam?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Whatever you are saying, absolutely. In talking, we really do much harm. We do a lot of time much harm because we are not conscious of what we are talking. And most of the times we are just talking to serve the demands of the ego. And that always hurts other people. That always really hurts. So rather than spreading a little joy and happiness, I'm just being a poison, really hurting people. Yeah. And we all have done that. I think all of us have our share of mistakes and errors. But not to dwell on that, that's what Mother shares again and again, that not to dwell in your whatever past regrets, you know, you may have. And it's okay. Now move on. Okay. Now how can I be better? How can I be better? Okay. Let me really pause and think whether it is necessary. Whatever I'm going to speak. Will it help? Or rather a silent prayer will help here. What will help? So I think really shabd, on words, Kabir ji also has said a lot. Kabir has many, many good couplets on where he says, Vani aisi boliye, man ka aapa khoye, auran ko seetal kare, aap hun seetal hoye. So he says that whenever you speak not from the ego. So he says, man ka aapa khoye, aapa is main. मैं भाव छोड़ के जब हम बोलते हैं कि मेरी डिमांड नहीं है इसमें दिस इज व्हाट इज बेनिफिशियल एंड इंपॉर्टेंट इन दिस सिचुएशन दैट्स व्हाई आई एम स्पीकिंग सो व्हेन वी पुट इट असाइड द डिमांड्स ऑफ द ईगो एंड स्पीक फॉर द बेनिफिट ऑफ माई सेल्फ एंड अदर्स इन द पिक्चर दैट्स व्हाट ही शेयर्स दैट ऐसी बानी बोलिए मन का आपा खोए औरन को शीतल करे दैट स्पीक दोज वर्ड्स विच आर कूलिंग विच हैव अ कूलिंग इफेक्ट ऑन अदर्स एंड आप हूँ शीतल होए सो दैट ऑल्सो हैज अ कूलिंग इफेक्ट ऑन यू एंड नॉट अ हीटेड अप इफेक्ट दैट द अदर पर्सन ऑल्सो यू नो ब्राइटन्स अप विद रेज एंड यू ऑल्सो काइंड ऑफ बिकम अ या एंटैंगल्ड इन द पिक्चर सो येस आई थिंक इट्स वेरी वेरी एंड समथिंग वी ऑल नीड टू वर्क अपॉन इट बिकॉज वी आर सो अनकॉन्शियस मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम्स दैट वी स्टिल मेनी अ टाइम्स से थिंग्स विच आर एब्सोल्युटली अननेसेसरी But to realize it and then move on, not to really delve in guilt and shame or there, you know, because that is not the place to go. Yeah. Yes, very important. Anyone wants to add on anything further? Okay, so I'm assuming there's nothing. Let's go ahead. So this is where I end the effort part. And then we begin choice and change. And this is what I had shared on the groups, WhatsApp groups also today about choice. We'll come to that later. To choose is an act of will. You know, so I'm willing something. I'm choosing something. Most of the time, we are not aware of this choice. You know, most of the times, I think, oh, where is this choice really? I don't see any choice. This is the way how I am. But then we see, we do have a choice. That some external happening may have happened. But what happens internally is a choice. So this is where we have to attain mastery and control. So something happens from external side. Most possibly, we take examples of challenging situations, like difficult situations, which are not really nice, right? And then my mind creates a whole story about that situation in me. Now, when I'm creating that whole story is being created because of an old pattern in me. That's my thinking pattern. That's my emotive pattern. So am I the pattern? Am I a thought pattern? Am I an emotional pattern? Or am I more than that? So then when we have hurt ourselves enough, that when we have ran ourselves enough, then we realize that, yes, this may have happened, but I don't want to react in the old way. I want to do something different. So let me stay with the breath and stay with my inner being. And whatever guidance I will receive, I'll act according to that. I will not react according to the action, reaction of the tendency that was going on in my head. So there is story coming up in the mind. You see the story coming up. It's not that the story is gone. But now you choose not to follow the dictate of the story because you are not the story. You are not the emotional or thought pattern. You have power. But most of the times we don't know we have power. That's why half of the life just goes by like that. So to choose from where I am acting in each situation, you know, something happened externally. How, where am I acting from? Am I acting still of the ego patterns or am I acting from a deeper inner being? So to choose is an act of will, how to make the right choice. And this is where, you know, I wanted to share this small anecdote of Nachiketa when he goes to the Yamraj and he's sitting there for 3 days. Yamraj is not there. And then when he comes, he says, oh my God, you Brahman, you know, you are a Brahman and you have been sitting here for 3 days. Okay, I give you 3 boons. And one of the boons, the last, first is that you give my father a clear mind, clear head, so that he's not angry over me and he's also not burning in anger himself. Second is something else. And then the third is, second is about the inner fire. And the third is about the secret of immortality. No, and then when he comes to, he talks about the first two boons, gives Nachiketa the first two boons. Then when he comes to the third boon, he says that this is too secret. This is not a knowledge which is to be given to everyone. So you take a lot of wealth, you take many, many princesses and kingdoms, but don't ask for this third boon. But Nachiketa is just hell-bent that all these things that you are giving me, these are just fleeting things. People will go away, relationships will change, wealth will go away, you know, skin will change. But I want this, you know, this knowledge I want. And then Yamraj says that since you have chosen what is beneficial over what is pleasant, I am going to grant you this boon. So wealth and luxury and all, you know, goodness and riches, so-called, of social life, it's pleasant, you know, it can be comforting bodily for those for those of us, it matters. For many of us, that material luxury may not matter much, you know. So for those of us, it's very pleasant, so much of wealth and kingdoms and palaces and all that luxury. But he does not take that and he takes the secret of immortality. So Yamraj says this because since he is making a choice, Nachiketa is making a choice. He's choosing the beneficial over the pleasant. What makes me grow in consciousness rather than what keeps me comfortable. So that's an example of right choice. Hundreds of times during the day we have choice to live from our deeper consciousness or to follow our surface nature. Hundreds of times, more than hundreds, you know. So many times we have this choice. Ki ab main kahan se act karu? Ego consciousness se act karu? Egoism se bolu? Apni likes, preferences se bolu? Ya jo uchit hai, that which is right and true and beautiful, from there I speak. Hundreds of times during the day, you have the choice to live from your deeper consciousness, no, or to follow your surface nature. So when we are running after a desire in the day and it's not being met, to take a step back and say, okay, so what? Let me utilize this time for some good purpose. So to give ego a corner space, let it be. And not to follow the dictates. Because if I run after desires, I know how much I suffer. So this choice we have to become conscious of this choice, that I have this choice. I'm not a victim of life and situations. I have this choice. Nobody can exert force on me if I don't let it. Okay. So she's sharing here that if you always choose to align your will, personal will, with what is deepest or highest in you, you will progress swiftly. It will be a smoother progress. So that's where I wanted that we will reflect upon it, that do we see, I'm sure that we see many, many times when we have chosen what was beneficial over what was pleasanter, you know, that you put yourself aside and you allowed something beneficial to happen, and how much empowerment it gives us, right? So if anyone wants to share, or many a times it may also come to your consciousness that there was a choice, there was a moment of choice where you could have chosen the deeper and highest, but you chose the surface movement. You were not able to align your will to the highest and deepmost self. So if anyone would like to share, let us pause here and maybe take a few.
In my case, you know, I've been trying to consciously live with my deepest and highest aspirations, but I also struggle to maintain the focus that is required. Quite often, you know, it gets distracted, and then something or the other keeps coming, and the attention goes away, and then you start living a normal life until it again comes back into attention. So I just don't know how to break out of this pattern, but this is a struggle that I have actually.
I think the only point here is, Birenji, all of us struggle just to keep at it. Keeping at it, because we know how much joy it gives us when we work from our deepest being.
That's right.
Yeah. So the troubles are going to be there. The lower being is not going to leave us that easily. So to know that the lower being is still there, and yet allow myself to make the right choices whenever I can. I will slip, but consciously whenever I can. Yeah.
Right.
So not to push away the lower being, because the lower being is here for us to shed light upon it. So if I keep on pushing, oh, why are you still there? Oh, I have done so much of, you know, reading and spirituality. Why are you still hanging here? It's not going to do any good, because it will hang in here. That's our task. To transform the lower being with our light and compassion is our task. So let it hang and you do your job. Yes. Yes.
Right.
Realizing true nature is important, madam. Realizing true nature is most, it is a divine work, you are told. That is where we have to lead, I think.
Absolutely. Yeah. So I think many a times during the day, we get many, many silent moments, you know, that we are not with many people around. We have quiet time with ourselves. Not to waste that time in excessive mental chatter, or maybe a newspaper or entertainment of some other sort, rather than to know ourselves as awareness in those silent moments. Mother talks about how to rest, and she says that rest in the highest possible consciousness that you can. But we don't rest like that. Mostly we rest in entertainment, most of us, you know, most of the times. So to choose, again, since we are talking about choice, so I could have watched TV here in the half an hour that I got, but I chose to rest in being aware of being aware, resting as awareness with my true nature, as Mohanji was stressing upon. So it's very, very crucial. You know, no suffering can come to an end if not for realization of our true nature. So you to use all these times before we are sleeping, while getting up, there is this silent time when we are waking up. We have not completely gotten up, half awake, you know, so to use that time also to be as awareness, you know, and we are awareness all the time, but consciously know ourselves as the presence of awareness, stabilize ourselves there so that it we can carry it forward during the day also, and become less of a slave of the egoistic consciousness and more work from this awareness within. Yeah, absolutely. Anyone wants to add on anything? or maybe share your reflections of when you were able to do that. Or yes, Swapna.
Yeah, I was wanting to address this, what the last person was sharing about, you know, how it can be so difficult. Like, we have our highest aspiration or goal for oneself, and how we have to, you know, what has been, I agree with you that one just has to keep at it. And recently I was noticing for myself what's been helping a lot to keep at it, or I have a tendency to go into worry and fear if something that is worrying or fear that can cause fear in me comes up. And in those moments, then I notice that's a pattern that has had so many repetitions. And so to do the opposite now, I have been using imagination to imagine, for example, Sherbindo's eyes. For decades, it's really been the mother that I felt more aligned to, though they say in the yoga, you may just spontaneously feel a pull more towards Sri Aurobindo or the mother. They're the same consciousness, manifestations of the same consciousness. So I never, it didn't, you know, it was never one or the other, but it just recently, Sri Aurobindo is whose eyes I imagine, and it brings a kind of focus. And the best of what I read about Sri Aurobindo, like mother saying that time when there was that big storm and she went into Sri Aurobindo's room to help him close the windows, and not one drop of rain was coming in because his peace was so, the peace that he emanated was so big. And so that quality comes through his eyes. And then I use that imagination to help then immediately when I'm going into that fear or worry, instead for Sri Aurobindo's peace to help me. And or I imagine even the mother placing her hands on, for example, if my solar plexus is feeling very tight, or the vital center, if the physical is reacting. And then I'm using the mother in that way of literally having her healing me and her strength supporting me, or even imagining her coming into my body. As she says, she's deep within, you look deep within your heart, you will find me there. And so just, I've been noticing recently that's been helping me a lot, and I've been feeling grateful for that. So I just wanted to share that, and it then helps me again come back to center, come back to peace, or my aspiration that let me be your soldier, mother, you know, let me be your warrior that she calls of us to not get caught in the lower movements.
Yeah, beautiful. Yes. So anything that helps, as you were sharing that for you it helps to concentrate on Sri Aurobindo's eyes, anything at all that helps. So you know, Jetsunma Tenzing Palmo, she shares that to focus on the object of devotion, whatever you have bhakti or a devotion or a sense of, you know, like a bowing down towards, just to cling to that higher evolved being. And she also specifically adds on that since we don't know when we are going to die, right? Death can strike anytime. So to make this, usually we are just lost in scattered thoughts here and there, some people in our life, maybe the past. So rather than being there, stick to the object of devotion. Parallelly, you also are working on realizing the true nature. That work has to go on. And yet we have many, many times when we have this empty space, you know, which is not that empty and which is a lost forest. So instead of that, cling to an object of devotion, or cling to light, you know, that light, growth, progress, cling to that, or cling to the, you know, for some people it may be Hanuman or Kali or Durga. It doesn't matter, whatever is we have, you know, a natural, heartful devotion towards. So to utilize that presence of that higher or evolved being or the divine being to guide you. And it really helps. So yeah, thank you for adding that on. Yeah. Yeah, anyone wants to share something from their life where they were able to make a decision, make a choice, where you put your ego aside, if you want to share, you were able to step aside and work for the beneficial thing rather than for what could have given you satisfaction. So putting this ego as the as a corner, at a corner, not shooing it away, that letting it be, and yet following the dictate of the heart, the wisdom of the heart. Yes, Jenny. Yeah.
See, I really wanted to go to Pondicherry this New Year Eve. Okay, so then my children, they have some exams coming up. So I really wanted to go. I discussed it with them. They said, no, Amma, this time it is not possible. So I felt a little bit disappointed because I wanted to go there and recharge my batteries and come back. So then after a while, I thought, okay, because one of your workshops I listened to Mr. James, he said that if it is an aspiration, you will not feel the disappointment. If it is a desire, you will definitely feel the disappointment. So, okay, anyway, I took it that way. And then I was going outside in the cab. Then I was thinking, okay, then maybe this is mother's wish. Okay, I will take the, she wants me to do some work at home. So I will take it. But then I was looking at the sky and I was going in the cab. I felt that it was in the middle of the road, but I can feel the vastness there. I felt the sky is so vast and I'm such a small, tiny being in that vastness. So I just closed my eyes for 2-3 minutes and it was such a beautiful experience that I felt the peace, the same thing that I will feel when if I go to Pondicherry. So then I thought, okay, okay, mother has asked me, I thought that, okay, you stay here, wherever you are, I will come. That way I felt very good. But these things happen, but as you say, it will not happen throughout the day. That some morning, something happened and I couldn't come out of it. Some episodes happen. And I was with the flow of my ego and my victim attitude. See, this happens only to me. And then I don't know how to come out of it. I literally went inside that whole episode. I completely forgot. It's not that I was not able to pull myself out. I felt that I completely forgot who I am. So then, okay, then after some time, maybe it took me more than half a day to realize that, see, I have lost myself in this drama. I have lost that touch, the connectivity with the self or with the mother. And then I felt, yes, no, I have to come back. But it takes a long time. Once I go into it, it takes very, very long time to come back. But as you said about silence in the morning, it was very silent. I was doing sometimes I will listen to some bhajans. So I thought I will put some, but it was so silent. I didn't want to put any bhajan. I just felt like going within myself. But I was doing some work, but it was so silent and all that. The same me, after 1 hour, it was altogether different me. I was, when something out happened, which I felt that this should not be happening, or maybe now I realize that, see, I want things to happen in my way. That is why it happened. So I slowly came out of it and I joined the session and then I read that your text message that about the choice and all that. After that, only I was able to come out of it. So these all the same things happened in the same day. That's what I wanted to share.
Yeah, thank you. Beautiful. I think the last bit that you shared, that after you read the message, then you were able to make that choice.
Yes. So amazing. When I saw the message, I thought, okay, then mother is pulling me out from this.
Yes.
Because one day I went into the drama, and when we came back and when I stood in front of mother, I felt, usually I will see the picture of mother. Then at that time I felt that there is a veil between me and the mother, that I am not sincere. I really, that word came from within me, that I am not sincere. All these days I was praying, meditating, and I thought thought that I'm doing something. I thought I'm reading this. I thought I know something. But that one fraction of second in front of mother when I stood for the first time in my life, I
Yeah, I think
so that's
we lost you for the last bit.
Yeah, I got another call because I'm attending from the mobile.
Okay.
So that one fraction of second, I really felt that I'm not sincere. Mm. But that moment, I didn't feel sad. Usually what I will do is, okay, I did this wrong. Monica's thing, when I listened to her talking last time, she said this and this is my goal. And see, I'm back to the normal self. So I feel sad. Then again, I go to the same ikti mode or to see everybody should listen to me mode. This, between these two, mostly I'll be in the victim mode. So, but that time in front of mother, I never felt sad. And I didn't even get the feeling that I have to do something. Yes, I'm not sincere. That felt good.
Yeah. More power to you. Yes. That's the way. Yes. Beautiful.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. So beautiful. So, you know, I think beautiful examples that Jayashree ji shared, that the power of choice, you know, that no matter how far we may have gone into the drama, because we will go into the drama again and again, old habits die hard. You know, so we cannot expect that in one day of hearing to the mother, listening to the mother, reading the words of the mother, change will happen. It takes a long time. But then we also see these little changes which makes us go forward, you know, that yes, I know that I should walk this path. So there is a knowing within which tells you where to go and to follow that knowing. So the choice, no matter if I had been plunging in the drama or stories in my head for 2-3 days at a stretch, it can happen. Or maybe many months, many years, at any point of time, I can make a U-turn. At any point of time, I can tell myself, okay, enough. You know, okay, let's move on. You know, enough of playing friends with the ego. Let me just take charge of my life and make my life beautiful. And this can happen anytime. That's what, you know, the Mother and Shorvindo share, that the surrender is based on free will. It's a free surrender, free will based surrender. So yes, you go into the ego's domain. Yes, go ahead. But whenever we choose, whenever we exercise the free will to choose, we have the capacity to drop the ego game and not to go into either the victim or the, you know, the big guy mode or the one who wants to get his expectations met, not to keep it aside and to follow what is truth, to follow what is right and beautiful. Satyam Shivam Sundaram. You know, so whenever we are following our truth, Satya, you know, then we are in Shiva's consciousness, which is awareness, the presence of awareness. I am that awareness which knows a thought. I am that awareness which knows this feeling. That is what I am. So to stabilize ourselves in that Shiva's consciousness, Satyam Shivam, and that creates a life which is beautiful. Satyam Shivam Sundaram. So, and we all deserve this beauty. We deserve to have a beautiful life, all of us. And it cannot happen if we do not unite with our own true consciousness. Yeah. And it will happen again. Old patterns die hard. It will happen again and again that I will identify myself with the thought stream. I'll identify myself with the feeling stream. You know, I'll again and again fall into that mistaken identity. But then the idea is to bring myself back, you know, and not to really go into guilt and shame much. Yeah? To notice it and then to move on. So, yeah. Anyone wants to add on? Anything from Rakhi or Shweta, Aradhana ji, anyone wants to share any reflection here?
You know, not really adding on anything, but I was, as I had written, I was looking forward for this session today. And I, you know, read the message. And yes, around 2 to 15, some drama, you know, just got me pulled in completely. And I lost the track of time. And then I suddenly picked up my phone and I saw it's 3:25. Okay, the session started and I have missed. You know, I didn't join at 3 o'clock. And then suddenly I saw Shweta's message. I mean, she's my college friend, Shweta, actually. And she's like, Rakhi, session has started. And I was like, okay, let me just join and see at max kya hoga. I maybe because it's continuing, I might not be taken in, which will be fine. But at least I tried. Let me do that. And the moment I clicked on join, I was taken in, and I'm so glad that I made that choice at that moment to at least let me try. Okay, if I would have not, or maybe just sulked feeling that, you know, I should have joined at 3, I would have missed all of this that I could hear or I could experience 3:25 onwards. So now what I have missed is only the 25 minutes, but if I would have not tried, I would have missed the whole thing. So, yes, so I, you know, these are small, small things which help us, I think, realize that, yes, you know, the choice that we make does.
Yes, beautiful. Yes. And, you know, why one may want to be in the session, because we come closer to our own self through such a session or something else that may be, you know, helping us. So it's about, and we all of us like to be closer to ourselves. All of us love to be in connection with ourselves, you know, those of us who are on the path. So that's what we miss. And to choose rightly, I think whatever you shared was really beautiful. Beck, even if 25 minutes are gone, okay, let me take in 10 minutes. You know, Kabir says on this, you know, there is a couplet, what you shared. He shares that, एक घड़ी आधी घड़ी आधी में पुनि आध कबीर संगत साधु की कटे कोटि अपराध. So he says that a good company, sat sangat, एक घड़ी, either you are able to do one moment, okay, एक नहीं कर पा रहे, half of it, half a moment, no, एक घड़ी, आधी में पुनि आध. So he is even reducing the half also further, कि half का भी half कर दो, 0.25. Even that much of drop of good company or words of Mother Sri Aurobindo, words of masters, you know, that cuts, you know, as if it cuts away your thousands of sins that one may have done. Why? Because then it helps me to again connect with my true consciousness and to let go of the ego consciousness. And if I continue the ego consciousness, that's pap. That's a prad. And if I come back to my true nature, that's what we are here supposed to do. So, yeah, more power to you for making such choices which connect to your inner being. Yeah, great. Thank you for sharing. Yeah, Aradhana ji, you want to share something?
Nahi, Monica.
Okay, no problem. Shweta, you have something to add on, share?
Yeah. Yeah, I would just share a general reflection, Monica, like slowly and gradually itna khud ko dekhne lagi hu, matlab, you know, itne bariki se ki samajh aata hai ki oh my god, matlab bade bade purifications to, you know, the larger ones are so easy, they are visible and aap dekhte ho aur reflect karte ho. Or largely, like, you know, like the larger good that you were talking, like larger, you know, like I feel largely, like, you know, I have worked towards larger good. So, wo aise lagta hai ki theek hai, itna thoda solace hai life mein ki, you know, like personal agenda ko zyada nahi dete hue, always, like, you know, for the larger good. So, wo to hai, that's okay. But you know, the minute impurities in you. Oh God, that is now, you know, just making its way out. And I can notice them, तो वो भी बहुत ही बारीक बारीक दाग जो है वो समझ आते हैं और उस पर चल रहा है. तो every moment बैठते you know खड़े होते कुछ सोचते these things are coming, oh my god, you know, like so it's like okay, the same thing I would have, you know, like helped somebody else to see and you know like reflect or you know pointed it out with the good intention. बट यही चीज दूसरे एस्पेक्ट में मुझ में भी है, यू नो, लाइक छोटे छोटे डॉट्स है, इट्स सो माइन्यूट दैट यू नो नाउ दैट बिकॉज ऑफ दिस सेशंस एंड यू नो गेटिंग क्लोजर टू माई सेल्फ आई कैन सी दैट एंड लाइक यू नो आई अंडरस्टैंड इट बेटर नाउ दैट द वर्क इज ऑलवेज ऑन योर यू नो ऑन योर सेल्फ सो दैट इज बिकमिंग क्लियरर लॉन्ग लॉन्ग वे टू गो बट Yeah, so I understand this purification part moment by moment, day after day, because loads to purify, loads and loads, you know. So yeah, that is what I wanted to share. Thank you.
Yeah, beautiful. Yes, totally resonate. You know, I read somebody said, I don't remember who was the master who said this. He said that we are all alchemists. You know, and we have this raw material of impurities. And we just have to work on it because we have the power, the light and the strength to make it into something really worthy and beautiful. So to make all these impurities that you were mentioning, you know, to transform all of them into almost their divine opposites. You know, we have that capability. That's why all of us are given that task. Otherwise, why would the divine give that task which is not possible? So the tasks that we have been given, allotted, it's just because we are capable. If I was not capable, then why would the mother, the divine mother, you know, give me that task at all? So also to slowly begin to trust our capability that yes, if I have seen a weakness in me, I also have the required strength to transmute that weakness. So yes, absolutely. Yeah, much work to be done. Lots of effort needed. Yes,
madam, you are talking from your true self. That is why it is appealing to all of us. Are you agreeing?
Yeah. So let us maybe take last one more slide I will take and then we'll just end the day today. So let's end here. And I think it's a beautiful point to end the session, which I had shared in the WhatsApp group also, this one by the mother. Anyone who would like to read it out would be really nice.
At every minute of your life, you must make a choice between what drags you down and what drags you up, between what makes you progress and what makes you go backwards. At every minute, one has to choose. This is indispensable. The choice, at every second, the choice is before you, and you may take a step downward or a step upward, take a step backward, or forward, and this state of choice must be constant, perpetual. You must never fall asleep, the mother.
Yeah. So to parallelly also become aware that when I am actually not choosing, you know, many a times we may feel that, oh, here I did not choose. There I just followed the natural tendency or the patterns or the sanskar, you know, what we say, the older patterns that have been running. So if I did not put effort in making a conscious choice, I chose not to choose. So there also a choice is happening, but it's a default choice. And the default is my tendencies, my thought patterns, my emotional patterns, the egoistic game. That is the default. So wherever I go forward, I have to make effort. In sliding down, there is no effort needed. Not at all. But to bring someone who has slid down, effort needed. Just like physics, you know, you go down the slide, not much of effort, fun. But try to climb up and you know you have effort. So it's physics, you know, whatever is happening also, it's quite related to the regular science that happens, you know, that needs effort. Upar jana hai to effort chahiye. If we want to grow our consciousness, we will have to put effort. And it's not that we do not have the capacity to put effort, but we put effort at the wrong side. We put effort on the side of the ego. That's why mother says that we put effort by playing friends with the falsehood. So now we have to put the same effort because we have the capacity, but on the side of the divine, which is, as Mohanji was mentioning again and again, true nature. Knowing oneself as the presence of awareness and not as the thought, feeling, sensations. Because there is always drama waiting for you to get entangled. Don't expect the drama to go away so soon. So every minute of your life, every minute, and how many minutes a day we have, we all know that. You must make a choice between that which drags you down, partnering with tendencies, identifying with thoughts, feelings, sense perceptions, clinging to my opinions, my ideas of life. I know the best. Clinging. So clinging drags us down. That's why Buddha called attachment is suffering. When I cling to my ideas, when I cling to my opinions, when I cling to people in life, this is how you should behave. You know, that clinging drags me down. And what draws you up? I have a choice whether I want to let go. I don't want to cling. I have clung enough. I don't know whether it's clung or clinged. Sorry for that English thing. Between what makes you progress and what makes you go backwards. So the moment I let go of the clinging, I'm okay. I'm not identified with the story. I am being myself. And the moment I cling to the story, I become the ego. And I suffer. So by suffering, I get to know, oh, I became the ego again. Time to get back, retrace my steps and, you know myself as the presence of awareness. Being aware of being aware. At every minute, one has to choose. This is indispensable. And this in which we grow in degrees. You know, now today, out of 100 moments, only 2 moments I was able to choose. It felt good. You know, as Jashiji was sharing, it feels good, you know, whenever something sincere happens. Then in the next day, maybe I fall back to one moment of choosing truth. Then slowly it grows. You know, many a times we also take step backwards and to be kind to ourselves, and it's okay. But also not to enjoy that okayness, to say that, yes, I will do better next time. The choice, at every second, the choice is before you, and you may take a step downward or a step upward, take a step backward or forward. So this is all choice. Every time a choice is happening, sometimes I'm not conscious of that choice. So to become conscious that I am choosing, if I'm not choosing, I'm choosing a tendency. If I'm not consciously choosing my true being, I'm actually choosing a tendency or a pattern or the egoistic state of consciousness. And this state of choice must be constant, perpetual, and you must never fall asleep. So giving yourself the choice to choose beauty, truth, satyam, shivam, sundaram, to choose beauty. Is this movement beautiful? Or is this ugly? So let me choose beautiful. Is this movement coming from being as true consciousness? Okay, let me choose this. And is it a movement of truth or falsity? Let me choose that. So each moment of life, we have this choice. And we don't know how many moments in life we have remaining. So to make the best of whatever we have left, we may be really young and we may think that I'm not going to die today, but who knows? So to make the best of our time here, That's choice. I think it's a very powerful theme that is coming now of choice, because I remember that when the first time I became aware that, oh my God, I have a choice. You know, that was years ago when I was diagnosed with cancer, 2014 ke kareeb, mujhe lagta hai. So there, you know, there when I was dealing with my own self, coming back home to myself, and that process still continues. But there was, that was the first time where I saw that whatever may be happening outside, but here is my choice, whether I want to progress towards beauty, truth, or whether I want to just fall to the story again. That's the choice. So to notice, to become conscious of ourselves whenever we are falling back to the story, and not to choose that. That's where empowerment lies. Yeah, anything anyone wants to add on, we can end here.
Monika, I am reminded of Dr. Alok Pandey also shared, I think in this From Desire to Aspiration, he shared, like, one of them asked, one of the audience asked him about, about good or bad, you know, moral or right or wrong, something like that. I vaguely, like, you know, remember. So he said, like, that is a difficult choice, but to go by to anchor yourself to truth, beauty, and harmony. So that stayed with me. So that is a good way of, you know, like, you know, taking things and deciphering, you know, like, you know, is it true, you know, beautiful, and does it bring me peace? So, yeah, that was nice.
Yeah, harmony is very important. Yes. Yeah. And Sri Aurobindo also that day, I don't know where we were reading. Yeah, maybe, I think it's maybe somewhere, maybe from the first chapter of Life Divine, I guess, that he says that all the problems of the universe are essentially problem of harmony. So harmony is absolutely crucial, and good that you brought that word up. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, then everyone, you know, thank you for joining. I'm assuming there is no further comment. Thank you for joining, sharing, and listening together. Yeah.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.